Hello, everyone. This is Jon Toor. I'm the CMO at Cloudian, and we're here today to talk about sovereign clouds, what they are, what they do. And we've got three experts in the subject matter with us today to talk about this. First is Rajeev Bhardwaj, the Vice President of Cloud Provider Solutions at VMware. Simon Hansford, the CEO of UKCloud. And Mike So, the CEO of Cloudian. Welcome, gentlemen. So let's go ahead and kick it off with you. Start with you, Rajeev. Talk a little bit about what the drivers are for sovereign clouds to begin with.
Thank you, John. First and foremost, right? It goes without saying, privacy and security is a foundation for all clouds, and it's table stakes. But when it comes to government agencies and regulated entities, especially in Europe and Asia, it goes beyond that. And it comes down to, government agencies and regulated entities are looking for complete jurisdiction, control, and authority for the over their data. That's one. Second thing is there's a lot of concern about when it resides on public clouds, there's concern about it being vulnerable. So that's the other driver. And then other thing that we are hearing from, our customers, especially in the government agencies and regulated entities, is they're very concerned about the critical data being managed by a US cloud provider, given the changing, geopolitical landscape. And then to top it off, there is this US Cloud Act, which gives the US government complete, access, jurisdiction, control of data, even though data is residing in a foreign nation soil, the government has access to data. So that creates a challenge for, our customers, especially the government agencies and regulated entities in Europe and Asia. So that's driving this need towards a sovereign cloud.
So who is a sovereign cloud provider?
When we look at, sovereign cloud providers, we look at least from our perspective, five key attributes of a sovereign cloud provider. First and foremost is the cloud provider should be an autonomous legal entity, should be a sovereign entity with sovereign ownership. So that's the first attribute. The second attribute is the data is subject to the jurisdiction control of the nation state where the data is collected. That's the second attribute. The third attribute is the foreign authority or legal entity are not able to assert jurisdiction control over the data when it resides in a foreign nation. And fourth attribute is, all data, it's customer data, metadata, is resident or controlled in that jurisdiction. And the fifth attribute of a sovereign provider is somebody, both from an operations and management perspective, they carry out both operations and management, is done by sovereign citizens of the nation with full auditing. So those are, John, the five attributes of a sovereign cloud provider.
So what is VMware's sovereign cloud strategy to enable those providers?
VMware's strategy, is to, in essence, enable VMware sovereign cloud providers to offer sovereign solutions to government agencies and regulated entities in the local markets. And, our view is it's really, the power of and, right? Delivering on the power of and, which starts with the VMware sovereign cloud stack, which gets deployed with sovereign controls, combined with local and national sovereign certifications that our providers bring to the table. So it brings the best of both. And as part of our VMware Sovereign Cloud initiative, what we are doing is we are enabling our cloud providers to deploy the VMware Cloud Verified stack with sovereign controls in that stack to deliver on data sovereignty, jurisdiction control, data access and integrity, delivering on data security and compliance, delivering on data independence and interoperability, and of course, data innovation and analytics.
What geos do you see adopting sovereign clouds?
Where we are seeing a lot of requests from our customers is primarily in Europe and Asia, where requests coming from government agencies, regulated entities, where there's concern about jurisdiction control, where they want sovereign entities to own and operate the cloud. That's where we're seeing a lot more customer requests coming in for sovereign clouds.
Okay, thank you, Rajeev. That's a great segue into talking with Simon over at UKCloud. So Simon, could you just start by briefly introducing UKCloud and how you're supporting the Sovereign Cloud Initiative?
Yeah, so very simple. UKCloud is a sovereign cloud provider that specifically focuses on the UK government and UK public sector. I think we're supporting this initiative really in two ways. One is absolutely about our providence, our credibility, our capability. And secondly, very importantly, it's about how we try and support and educate the market about the need for sovereign cloud. You know, so as a business, you know, we've been a sovereign cloud provider really since our inception 10 years ago. You know, from day one, we have positioned, messaged, and importantly, campaigned about the importance of data sovereignty. And we can demonstrate and prove this to our customers that their data will only ever reside if hosted with us within the UK and is only subject to UK laws and jurisdiction.
Rajeev talked about the drivers of the sovereign cloud. Can you expand on that as well?
Rajeev absolutely nailed it on the head that data privacy and security are table stakes. Absolutely. If you don't know where your data is stored, you don't know where copies of your data reside, then it's very hard for you to be able to secure it. And importantly, as Rajeev made it, the key issue here is about a compelled access and whether governments, jurisdictions can request access to that data. But probably most importantly, where I am absolutely passionate about goes beyond privacy and security. It's about the national importance of data. Yeah. I believe it fuels the economy, it fuels innovation. And if you're not in control of that, it's very hard for that for it to become a national asset. Yeah. If data is to be the new oil, which many commentators talk about, if it's to become a currency in its own right, you need to be able to secure and derive value for the benefit of your own country. Today, it's widely reported that 92% of data in the Western world is hosted in North America. Now, if that is the case, and I believe it to be true, then it's very hard for, in my case, a British company to be able to take control of the data, to be able to share it legally, to have the relationships with other companies that allow them to get practical access to that data, to be able to collaborate, have insights, and find discoveries.
Some providers offer local zones that provide, one level of capability versus a sovereign cloud. And I think this comes down to a distinction between data sovereignty versus data residency. Can you explain the difference between sovereignty and residency?
It's absolutely key in that the differentiation is really important. Not only to the debate, but the legal status of your data. So data sovereignty, that's where all of your data, whether that be customer data or account data, is stored locally in the sovereign cloud provider and nation. And it cannot be accessed or transferred by the cloud provider for support purposes, for DR purposes, for backup or anything else. And it generally means that the staff of the cloud provider are sovereign nationals and probably have the security clearances and are certainly subject to the national laws of the country. Therefore, your data is fully protected. Data residency is of a lower level. Yeah, that's where your customer data may be held in the local zone in the sovereign nation, but the account information is not necessarily. And frankly, it's the account information that can be as powerful, as insightful, as incriminating, and as valuable as the data itself. Here we're talking about not only the metadata, but login, passwords, network, IP addresses, diagnostics, logs, API calls and information. And if you have all of that, quite frankly, you can often derive the data in its own right. But most importantly, data residency, the customer data is still subject to controlled access by the foreign entity.
Okay, so Mike, talk a little bit about Cloudian and how Cloudian storage benefits the sovereign cloud.
So Cloudian is designed from the ground up for data sovereignty. We have a powerful policy engine that allows precise control on data placement by location, multi-tenanted access control, and storage security, including encryption, object lock, air gap, and data immutability. And Cloudian behaves exactly like the public cloud, but it's deployed in sovereign cloud data centers. It can start small, can grow to massively scalable geo-distributed clusters, and we support the most compatible cloud S3 APIs, which means that all cloud-enabled applications, including Kubernetes, AI/ML, and thousands of other S3-enabled applications, are all guaranteed to work on a Cloudian system. Finally, Cloudian is a proven solution. It's already used by dozens and dozens of sovereign cloud providers and other government agencies all around the world. We have customers in government agencies on every continent.
So I know that Cloudian and VMware have obviously been working closely together on this sovereign cloud initiative for a bit now. Can you talk a little bit about how Cloudian and VMware together are working to make this, you know, easy for cloud providers to implement?
Yes, Cloudian has done a lot of work together with VMware to integrate the Cloudian solution into the VMware management and billing framework so that sovereign cloud providers can have a completely seamless experience. Firstly, the Cloudian software is available through the VMware Cloud Provider Program. It's a single transaction. You can use Cloud Provider Program points. It's a consumption model, so it's pay-as-you-go, start small. And finally, all the management features are fully integrated with the VMware Cloud Director, so it's a truly seamless end-user experience.
Simon, if you could just talk a little bit about the future of sovereign cloud. Where do you see sovereign cloud headed in EMEA in the future?
I'm saying in all the territories that I'm working in, that politicians and regulators are starting to create policies and legal frameworks that ensure their clouds and the data is treated as a national asset. We're seeing that throughout Europe, the Gaia-X initiative. We're seeing that in a massive way in the Middle East, where sovereignty is enshrined in law. And many of these countries, Middle East, Africa, on one hand, it being courted by the West, on the other hand, are being courted by China. And yet, many of them, frankly, are ex-colonial countries, and therefore sovereignty and being able to have control themselves, they're fiercely independent. And sovereign cloud is high on their agenda.
The interest and the need for it is growing. So I thank you guys very much for joining us for a few minutes here talking about it. Appreciate your time. We'll be right back.